It's October. It's stewardship month. Thank you. Really. Our theme is Journey to Generosity. All month we're going to be talking about stewardship and giving of money and time and talents. At the end of the month, as Jennifer said, and as all of you have read in your letters, we will ask you to bring in your pledges, cards on which you have indicated how much you can contribute to this congregation and our ministries, whether it's time or talents or money or some combination of the three. This week, we're collecting a special offering for the Disciples Pro-Reconciliation Anti-Racism Mission Imperative. And today there is a special offering request for Bread for the World, so that we can help feed people around the world in places like Sudan, where they've been having famine for years and years and years. All of these things relate to each other. They all ask for money. Today's also World Communion Sunday. And when we add that to the mix, it changes everything, because now all those things are about how to love the neighbor. In today's scripture reading, Moses was not feeling the love. He cried out to the Lord, "What should I do with this people? They're getting ready to stone me." They had moved from one camping place to another, and there's no water at the new place. Lack of water is a major problem, because it wasn't just that there were a whole lot of people traveling together. They had herds and flocks to be cared for, which also required a lot of water. If you've had cattle or sheep or pigs or any livestock of any kind, it takes a lot of water. And they were worried. They were pretty sure they were going to die of thirst in the wilderness, and obviously it's all Moses' fault. He planned it that way. The people of Israel were really good at forgetting. In chapter 16 of Exodus, they had complained to Moses that they were going to starve to death, and it was his fault for bringing them out of Egypt, where they claimed there was always plenty to eat. And God responded by providing manna every morning and quail every night, every morning and every night, except the Sabbath. And in preparation for the Sabbath, he sent twice as much the day before. That did not stop when they moved. The manna and the quail kept coming day after day after day for the entire length of their journey, like 40 years. But now they're out of water. And once again, they wish they're back in Egypt, where they claimed there was always plenty of water to drink. And God responds by having Moses strike a rock with his staff and cause sweet water pour out of that rock. He did this in front of witnesses, the elders and the leaders of all the tribes of Israel, men who were trusted by the people. So there was no question but that God provided the water, using Moses and his staff as tools to make the miracle happen. God had made pretty good use of that staff. Moses just used it to, herd sheep with. But God turned it into a snake while Moses was confronting Pharaoh. And then he used it to make a path through the water so the Israelites could walk through the sea without drowning. To the people of Israel, Moses' staff became a symbol of the presence of God. But every time things got just a little bit rough along the way, the people forgot what God had already done for them. They misremembered their past in Egypt as being soft and comfortable. They kind of forgot about the whole slavery thing. They forgot about the time when the Pharaoh had all their baby boys killed. They forgot about the Pharaoh forcing them to make bricks out of straw. withholding the materials they needed to make bricks strong enough to build the buildings they needed to build in order to get aid, you know, so they could have food and water. They forgot all those things. And they forgot what God had done for them. They forgot where the manna and the quails came from every day. They lacked faith that God would continue to provide for them no matter how much proof they had. And you know, I think we can kind of sort of excuse them for that. Because after all, they'd sort of fallen away from an understanding of who God is in the 400 years or so that they lived in Egypt. They weren't used to living by the law that Moses had just brought down to them from the mountain. It didn't yet have the centuries of tradition behind it that it would by the time Jesus came along. They weren't used to having a steadfast, faithful, and loving God in their lives. They were used to the gods of Egypt, who had to be constantly placated and whose love had to be purchased repeatedly. They were used to gods who asked their worshipers, "So, what have you done for me lately?" Not a God who would pour blessings out upon them for no reason other than they were God's own beloved children. This was just such a foreign concept to them, that this God they didn't know well at all would pour out abundant bread and water in the midst of the wilderness, in the midst of a place where no bread or water could be found, and that that God would require nothing of them in return for that abundance, except to care for each other in accordance with the law that Moses had brought down from the mountain. This was all very, very new to them. So maybe we can kind of understand why they had so much trouble trusting that God would provide for them. This is not new to us, however. We should know these things. We shouldn't have any trouble at all having faith that God will provide for all of our needs. We should be well aware that nothing is impossible with God. If God wills it, it's going to happen one way or another. That does not mean, however, that everything we need to do the work of this congregation or any congregation will just sort of fall into our laps. God did expect the Israelites to go out and collect the manna every morning and make it into bread, and to go out and catch the quails to cook them for their dinners. God put the opportunities in front of them and anticipated that they would do what was necessary to make best use of those opportunities. God expects that in gratitude for all the blessings we have received, that God's people will take care of each other, that all the able-bodied will take care of the less able, and the adults will take care of the children, and the adult children will take care of their aging parents, and that every person would watch over her neighbor to make sure they were okay. Or as the prophet Micah reminded us, God expects us to do justice and love kindness and to be humble in our walk with God. Bread and water. Regardless of what some dietitians would tell us, these two are absolutely necessary for life. We receive these things in abundance, as did the people of Israel in their journey to the Promised Land. And we share those things that we have in abundance because that's what God requires of us. Some of us have enough money that we can share it with others. We might be pretty comfortable and don't have to worry about making donations of 10% or more of whatever we have. Or we might not have a lot to give. We might find 10% is a challenge or even a hardship. But every little bit given to a cause that matters to you $1 helps. If you give $1 to Week of Compassion or Reconciliation or Bread for the World, that $1 will be added to lots of other $1, and together they will make a huge difference in lives somewhere. If you put $1 in the offering plate here every Sunday, one of these little ways, $1 every week is $52. That's like 3 cases of copy paper. Seriously, that's a big deal. $1 is a big deal. Some are blessed with gifts. Beautiful voices. We just heard a bunch of them, right? Some have the ability to dance. Some are great at playing instruments. Or they have the gift of prayer, or teaching, or speaking, or being an administrator, or building and repairing things, or of coming up with brilliant, crazy ideas. Gifts of this nature are a blessing to share with one another in this congregation. Some of us are blessed with an abundance of time that we can spend helping wherever we're needed, at the food pantry or Christian cafe, or doing things that are needed around the church, or in some other way that makes your heart sing.
Sorry.
Quiet, Siri. Giving of ourselves, of our gifts and our talents and our time is a blessing to everyone. And on this particular Sunday, we come together with all other Christians to celebrate the Lord's Supper. On this particular Sunday, every year, no matter what our differences might be, and y'all know we have a bunch of differences, all Christians come together around this communion table. In some traditions, there will be elders presiding. In others, only an ordained minister of that particular denomination is allowed to preside at the table. In some traditions, they'll serve wine, in some juice, in some you get a choice. The bread will be different from country to country. Today, we will be sharing bread from Mexico and rice cakes and unleavened bread. So we have choices that we might find elsewhere. In every congregation today, we will all gather around this table to remember the Last Supper. We will gather around this table and give thanks to the Lord our God for the gift of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We will share this meal in remembrance of his life and his death and his resurrection. Regardless of our many differences, today we celebrate. Let us take time to remember the gifts of God's grace with which we are so richly blessed. Let us take time to remember where all the gifts of resources and time and talents come from. Let us dedicate ourselves to giving back what we have been so freely and lovingly given. Let us pledge our lives and all that we are to the Lord our God, from whom all things come. Amen. If you are not yet part of